हेलो
सर। यस सर।
विल स्टार्ट एज ए जॉइंट
यस सर। यस सर कैन स्टार्ट सर।
आर विल वेट पार्टिसिपेंट जॉइंट आर व्हाट
जॉइंट सर। जॉइंट मैक्सिमम पार्टिसिपेंट जॉइंट फ्यू मोर आर जॉइनिंग सर। आई एम एडमिटिंग। या यू कैन स्टार्ट सर।
ओके आई वेलकम ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स फॉर द सेकंड प्रेजेंटेशन ऑफ दिस सेशन. The speaker is Dr. Vasu Golangi, General Manager, Fuel Cell Research Center, BHEL, Hyderabad. Dr. Vasu has a vast experience in the field of fuel cell technology. He received a Scotch Order of Merit Award under Corporate Excellence for development of solar passive tracker. He has also received the AICT National Doctoral Fellowship Award during the financial year 2005 to 2006. To his credit, he has 8 patents, 9 registered designs, and 2 copyrights. He has published about 20 papers in international journals and 10 papers in international conferences. He has worked and completed many international and national sponsored research projects. He is also an invited speaker in many conferences. I welcome you, sir, Dr. Vasu Golangi, for delivering your lecture.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah.
So shall I thank you
for the
well introduction.
Yeah, thank you.
Shall I share my screen?
Yeah.
Am I audible?
Yeah, audible.
Okay. Are you able to see the screen?
Yeah, yes, some noise is coming, but some noise is coming. I think fan sound.
Okay.
Now it's good.
Is it okay now?
Yes, sir. Okay, sir.
But there was no fan here now. Some sound. Okay. Maybe. Now it is now. There is no noise now.
Okay. Shall I start?
Please.
Yeah, good afternoon to all the speakers and maybe a few maybe students and a few maybe lecturers and maybe some industrial participants.
No, most of them are faculty members of different colleges.
Okay, from different institutions. Okay, this is completely faculty development program.
Yeah, it's a faculty development program.
Okay, I thought some of your PhD students are...
Some are there. No issue. Yeah.
So this is, I'm giving you whatever you might have heard from the morning, from yesterday's session, maybe more of theory and basic science and different class of fuel cells. And maybe in the morning sessions also, if you have covered, I think Anil Verma sir and I think Singh sir. So they must have covered to the extent possible of theory maximum. So my lecture is more of a from industrial perspective. It is industries typically work for the commercialization or what are the possible areas which you can commercialize typically they will look at the any kind of technology which you would like to work on in commercial research. They look at the four parameters. SWOT analysis, they call it as typically strength, weakness, and what is the rest of the things are the business related things. So their strength and weakness is more critical. So what is the strength and what is its weakness? So first two are more critical. So the strength is that it is of main, the technology of any fuel cell technology is of clean in nature. And the weakness is economics, the cost. So these, I am looking at more of the economical point of view, how the fuel cells can be a complementary for the current electric vehicles in the coming days. Not in all the segments, you may not expect in two wheelers or three wheelers, probably you could expect from the cars and trucks, buses, railways. These are all the things can be seen in future with the fuel cell technologies instead of IC engines. But battery, anyhow, it will be there always. It always a complementary thing for the fuel cell, or fuel cell may complement to the battery, or either vice versa. Either one can happen. So this is a brief introduction. Why I'm giving the leapfrogging means it can take a bit steep change certain areas than the battery technology in heavy duty vehicles, particularly where the batteries are subjected to fail because of its weight and the cost of ownership, typically that will increase. So with this, I would like to give a small introduction about the what we are going to talk about, and more in terms of more statistical things may be there in the coming slides, you can see. So just as a brief, I'm giving you the basics of the fuel cell, and because these are all like a hen and a chicken problem. This is, unless the hydrogen gets cheaper, the fuel cells cannot take off. They claim unless fuel cells becomes cheaper, the hydrogen cannot take off. But they both are interlinked. So they both can be seen in the coming slides. So typically, fuel cell is a kind of a electrochemical device. So it consists of two compartments, like what you see in the batteries. So I hope everyone is aware of the batteries, because everyone uses battery in daily life in either form. Either you use it in vehicle, or you may use it in the UPS at home, or everywhere it will be there, even in cell phones, everywhere you could see. Nowadays, without battery, there is no life. So you are carrying always a battery with you. Wherever you out of 24 hours, you may be spending time around battery at least some 16, 17 hours in either form. It may be in cell phone, or it may be in your home UPS, or it may be in office, wherever it is. Like that, so people are aware about the battery. They have two electrodes. One is positive plate. I will simplify as a positive plate and negative plate. And the intermediate is a electrolyte media. It works like a conducting media. It works like a conducting. It's like a semi, the dielectric material. Electrically, it is an insulative material in any kind of electrochemical device. The electrolyte typically is an insulative material. It will not conduct any electrons. It will conduct only ions. So it is a semi-permeable membrane which allows certain class of ions. Either it could be a negative class or it could be a positive class. So that is the basic roles of the each components. Where in the negative plate, you can see the oxidation where the electrons are released. So that will be passing to the external circuit. They call it as, in fuel cells, we call it as a anode plate, but in battery, they use a different terminology. They use it as a negative plate and positive plate to avoid confusion. So electrons will be transferred towards the external circuit through which it will be neutralized on the other side, at the cathode side or the positive side, where the reduction takes place. And it can cause to a chemical change. In case of fuel cells, the hydrogen ions will transfer from negative plate to the positive plate. And at positive plate, in presence of neutralized electron and oxygen in presence, it forms a water. Similarly, electrolyzer, it is similar to that fuel cell, only construction, everything is similar, but in operation they are different. Instead of fuel cells gives electricity, but whereas in electrolyzer you have to give the electricity. So it produces the fuel. There are different class of electrolyzers, but it produces the fuel as long as you give the water and electricity. But there is a different class. You need not to give water. You can convert the carbon dioxide to probably, Verma sir has covered, I think. So carbon dioxide can be converted to methanol or methane, some useful chemicals. That is also electrochemical, which is very hot area now. People are exploring the possibilities to neutralize the cycle of CO2, which typically release majority of the CO2 comes from power plants. So where you can capture the CO2 at some place, from there you can convert into useful chemicals. So here the process is similar, where whatever the class of electrolyzer is, you have to give electricity. Some voltage you have to, differential voltage you have to give, under which it consumes some current and convert the water or chemicals to a useful chemicals or hydrogen. So this is process of electrolysis. So these are the typical off-cell reactions, where at a negative plate, in case of fuel cells, electrons will release and hydrogen also will be transferred from one side to the other side, anode side to the cathode side. Whereas in cathode side, oxygen is consumed in presence of the hydrogen, which is coming from anode to cathode, gives water. And it's a typically an exothermic reaction. Though it is electrochemical, but in nature, it's a combustion reaction. It's like a hydrogen combustion, but it's a electrochemical combustion, they call it as. We can call it as an electrochemical combustion. Similarly, in case of electrolysis, you have to expel the from water, you are expel the electrons and ions. So at the anode side, it is connected to the positive plate. So you will get a positive ions and electrons. At cathode side, this hydrogen again will be transferred to the negative plate side, because the ions will have a nature of a positive. So obviously tend to go to the opposite side. So there it consumes electrons plus H plus ions, gives pure hydrogen gas. The major advantage of this electrolysis is the purest form of hydrogen you will get. There will not be any kind of a impurities like a carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide, nothing will be there, because the pure water only will be used. They use typically deionized water. And the oxygen shortage, we are all aware of because of this pandemic situation. And the process of generating hydrogen, the oxygen is a byproduct in electrolysis reaction. So typically, commercial grade oxygen, you will get air separation plants. Where the nitrogen is separated from the air, oxygen will be pressure swing absorption. They will separate the oxygen and fill it in the bottles. But this is another route where the oxygen is a byproduct. Hydrogen is the main product. So oxygen will be left, or it can be used for any other applications. You can compress it and dry it, and you can compress it and bottle it, and you can sell it, because you know the demand of oxygen nowadays. So this is the biggest advantage. You can sell the oxygen other than hydrogen. The cost is more in oxygen nowadays. So this is just a flavor about the battery I'm giving. It's whatever we have discussed at a glance. So typically it consists of two electrodes. So it's a typical lithium battery cell, where the lithium ions will be moving from positive to negative charge while you are charging. While discharging, the other way you can see. So lithium will be coming back to the positive plate. So in case of fuel cells, I'm just giving the resemblance, like IC engines, we are all familiar because many of you are mechanical engineers. So in case of IC engines, the engine will give the power and the tank is the oil storage tank, which will decide the how long you can go. So that is power and energy are decoupled systems. Whereas in battery, that is not the case. Power and energy, both are coupled system. They are like in a sealed container. So if you want more mileage, you cannot vary the oil level and all. You cannot carry, you have to carry additional battery, and it's not that easy to, practically it's not easy. But whereas in case of IC engines and all, simply you can carry, if at all you feel that there is no oil is available in the next few miles, you can still use your, you can pick the bottle and you can pour it. Similarly, in fuel cells also, you have the flexibility of the same. You have the hydrogen gas separated tank. The advantage with this is you can have an additional tank always. So as you have an additional tank, you will get a mileage extra. So that is the main advantage with the decoupled systems. Since the energy and power are decoupled, they can be always better to handle, and you will, customer will have a better flexibility. So if you look at the gravimetric densities of the batteries, the current state of the batteries, so the lead acid conventional is, everyone is aware, it has the lowest 38 to 40 watt hours per kg, whereas the extreme you can see nickel cobalt aluminum battery, which is used in Tesla cars. So that's why they get the highest mileage, 500 kilometers, 540 kilometers per charge. So they get almost, the recent one they claim is 280, they are touching watt hours per kg. That is the highest. So typically we use batteries is typically in automobile applications is lithium ion batteries. These are all the densities, whatever I have given, they are all at the system level densities, not the cell level. That means certain number of cells will be connected together to form a pack. That is called, it comes with the BMS. Battery management system. So typically LFP comes around 9 kgs including everything per kilowatt hour. So this is the trade-off plots. You can decide according to your application. If you are so interested in fast discharge, you can choose the lithium titanate batteries where the discharge rates are very fast and charge rates are also very fast. But if you want to have a very constant application loads, you will have a 1C charging, that means constant charging and constant discharging. So you will have a constant load application. Such kind of things you can use. It depends on your application. You can go either LFP, you can go, currently we are using LFP, more frequently people are using LFP and NMC, lithium manganese cobalt and NMC. These three batteries are conventionally used in automobile applications. Of course, lithium titanate oxide also people are using in, this is called ultra fast charging batteries. So, but they are limited by the distance in electric buses. But whereas if you look at the life, that means one charge and one discharge is called one cycle. When you charge the battery to the maximum capacity, 100% is state of charge, it is. And when you discharge it to 20% is whatever they say as per the battery manufacturer. That is called one cycle. Typically, LTO batteries will have the highest number of cycles because of its chemistry in nature. So thermal runaway is the safety parameter which people will use for the safety reasons. So typically the preferred value is always highest temperature. So higher the temperature, lesser the risk. So this nickel lithium cobalt oxide batteries will have the lowest temperature. That means they catch fire once the cell temperature reaches above 150 degrees centigrade. So lithium manganese oxide and another battery, that is NCA battery, they are very thermally sensitive. They catch fire even at the low temperatures also. But conventionally, this is the reason why people use the LFP batteries, lithium ion phosphate, because they have a thermally not sensitive. So the tolerance temperature is more, it may not catch the fire. And it's the respective voltages as per the chemistry of anode and cathode. So cast strand of the lithium metal, if you look at the demand, and as the price of the, as the demand is increasing every year because of the usage of lithium metal in lithium batteries manufacturing, from the year 2002, if you see, that is all about a tonnage cost. It was about $2,000 per ton. But whereas it, when the time it reaches the, now the cost is somewhere around $20,000 in 2020, the recent values are. So the biggest disadvantage is you will not have a price control on this. And majority of the world reserves in lithium are 70% of the lithium reserves are owned by China only nowadays. So the rest are all owned by America and other countries. India, by bad luck, we don't have much reserves, very minor. Somewhere in Kerala and some other places. In North, I think one or two places. Not much. It's a very fractional amount on it. So because of that, instead of depending on the crude oil, again, we have to depend on the lithium metals, on some others, or on our enemies' countries like China. So it is not a good sign for the positive progress of the nation. So we have to choose for the alternative kind of things. Being China has so much of lithium reserves, in fact, they are also moving to the fuel cells because they know that recycling of lithium is very costlier than the making a lithium from the raw materials, raw ore metals. So that's why people are slowly leaving the other side, restricting themselves, not scattering the lithium batteries for all the applications. They are limiting to two-wheelers and small cars and all, not for long range and heavy duty applications. So the, and they are cutting the subsidies in China for the, from 2020 January onwards, there were no subsidies for the, other than two, three states, I think Shanghai and two more states were having the still subsidy, but majority of the states have cut the subsidies for battery vehicles. They are promoting the fuel cell vehicles. So to encourage for the clean fuel, and the fuel which they are getting is currently from the coal. So coal reserves are huge in China. Like India is fortunate to have so much of coal reserves. Like in India, they do have a huge amount of coal reserves in China. So they convert coal to hydrogen through gasification process, and they get hydrogen the cheapest price possible in compared to all other technologies available for the hydrogen production. So this is the, and they are making the cost competitive in comparison with the gasoline or diesel or petroleum, whatever it is you call any kind of a fossil fuel. They are making a competitive price through different policy routes given by the government of China. Of course, in India also, for the last 1 year, government also pursuing seriously through different communities and taking the feedback how to promote and trying to make some policies and standards and guidelines how to go ahead about in this concern. A lot of work is happening at the government level also, and different public sector companies also involved in that. So if you look at the abundance of the materials, lithium stands here. It's not so abundant. So when compared to the common metals of silicon, iron, and other materials, sodium, magnesium, titanium, and other things. So silicon, once you start consuming the lithium, it is, I don't think a whole lithium metal will be consumed within 10 years if you replace all the vehicles. It doesn't even satisfy the 10 years need. So that is the biggest problem. So people are looking for the multiple alternative kind of technologies other than batteries. Of course, battery means not only lithium, there are multiple technologies within battery itself. Recently, new batteries are coming with the solid state electrolytes where you have a good amount of cycle life, and looking for alternative materials also. Very serious research is going on in this direction. So this is from customer point of view. Nowadays, people are because of the incentives given by the automobile manufacturers for promoting the electric vehicles. And if you look at the prices of the diesel or petroleum, you all aware that now the price of petrol is already crossed 100 rupees. I don't know about the rest of the states. In Hyderabad, it is 101.5 now already. So and it is expected to go further higher also. So in that concern, people are now started thinking, shall we opt for a battery vehicles if possible? Because conventionally, as on today, the fuel cell vehicle is very costly. Let us be factual. So the fuel cell vehicle, if you look at the similar kind of features and all, it is still 30% to 40% higher than the conventional fuel vehicles. In that aspect, electric vehicles are relatively better. They are only about some 30% higher than the petrol or conventional diesel vehicles. But the advantage in electric vehicles is you need not to pay that much of money in operating cost. So where you will gain your money in terms of operating cost, though you pay the money a little upfront as a capital cost, so you can get it. And government also is encouraging to give subsidies. If you buy a small scooter also, government is giving 5,000 rupees subsidy. If you buy a car, government is paying you about some 50,000 rupees subsidy on cars and all. So whatever the price you get, that is after subsidy one. So you may not able to see clearly, but it is after subsidy one that the dealer will climb through the company OEM. So at this juncture of the confusion, it's a dilemma. Now the customer is in dilemma mode, which one should I opt? The things are very clear. If you are really driving very frequently to long routes, then you can probably think of a conventional diesel vehicles or petrol vehicles. But if your mobility or the moving is limited to below 100 kilometers, it is better to go for electric vehicles. Now the electric vehicles are offering much better. So if you look at the Hyundai Kona, on real time, it is giving almost 290 to 310 kilometers per charge. That is good enough for a daily usage and to roam around, just to leave in the morning and come back in the evening for any outings and all. But like a cab service and all, they need a diesel vehicles because their time is money. So in case of battery vehicles, the disadvantage is you have to wait for the at least 1 hour. They call it as a fast charging batteries. Even fast charging batteries requires minimum 55 minutes even today. 55 minutes to 70 minutes. So he cannot wait, and customer will scold him. He cannot make him wait. So he has to prefer such kind of conventional vehicles only. In such kind of requirements, fuel cells will be better, where you need not to wait. The gas can be filled, hydrogen gas can be filled within 5 minutes. So it's like a conventional CNG vehicles only. Whatever the time required to fill the CNG, similarly, you need only the similar time for the same thing. So that is it is up to the choice of the customer based on his need and application. Coming to the performance comparison about the different kind of technologies currently available as on today, that is, we are considering here as a diesel based and diesel hybrid. This is typically for a 12 meter bus. It's a 40 feet bus given by the US National Renewable Energy Laboratory. Yes, it works with the Department of Energy also. And a CNG bus and fuel cell electric and battery bus. So the fuel economy, if you look at that is, this is typically the number of miles which you get per gallon diesel. So typically in US, they use it as a number of gallons. The one gallon is 3.7 liters. So how many miles you get per gallon or per 3.7 liter of diesel, whatever you call it as diesel or petrol, whatever you say. So in case of diesel bus, you will get a 4.5 miles per gallon. A hybrid means you will get a close to 5.7. And CNG, you are getting, this is all equivalent. So it doesn't mean that CNG is equivalent energy base, 1:1 on energy basis. So how much of diesel it has? 1 gallon diesel will have a 33.6 megajoules of energy. So how much the diesel cost of equivalent energy? So if you look at the energy mapping, so diesel will give 3.5 miles. Whereas battery can give, that is not clearly given here, but fuel cell will give almost 7 miles. That is 1 gallon of gasoline is equivalent to 1 kg of hydrogen. So now if you look at the mileage in terms of equivalent energy, fuel cell based electric will give the highest. If you look at the range, you know, all this conventional diesel, petrol will have the range. Highest range there possible. If you, once you fill the bus or lorry, whatever truck is, you will get more than 500 kilometers plus. But whereas in battery, it is limited to currently, I think BYD is giving maximum 350 kilometers only. 350 they claim, but it will not come for 350. Probably it will give at max 310 or 290 only, like Kona one. Kona also they claim 350 plus. But on road, it will come only 290 or 300 at max. So in that case, fuel cells are better side. So they give even 480, even 500, whatever you want. Extra, you need, if you need more mileage, you just add one additional cylinder on the other side. Because the cost of, the weight of the hydrogen cylinder is very low compared to the equivalent energy given by the battery packs. So if you look at the refueling time, typically, this diesel, all these things will take not more than 4 to 5 minutes. Whereas fuel cell is what, though they have shown here, but in the recent, because of the advancements of the cryogenic cooling and other issues, and they were able to fill within 6 minutes itself, even fuel cells. But even the batteries cannot be, fully charged. It's not even a within 1 hour. It's very tough. Even now also 70 minutes it's taking to get fully charged. Though they call it as a fast charging. But household charging, if you see, it takes at least 10 hours. They give typically all these electric cars and all, they are giving 16 amp plugs. So using which you can charge at your home itself, the electric car. So even it requires full night charging. But whereas in fuel cells, though they have given 9 minutes, it's high. But now because of the technology advancements, because of the high compression, the fuel gets heated up. But because of, again, they are having so much of cooling advancements in the cryogenic cooling, using cryogenic cooling and other technologies, they are able to fill the hydrogen in the tank within 6 minutes. So if you look at the overall aspect, this is only to get you there. Feel of it, so of the future, how the transportation is moving towards. So this was one of the interesting slide, what the government at national level, the program has taken place. So from 2012 onwards, China government has started the program of electric new energy vehicle program, NEV they call it as. They started after 2012. So they have adopted for certain class of vehicles like light duty vehicles, buses, and some kind of a small cars and all. Once they started replacing 25,000 they started in 2014, they replaced a few number of vehicles and they were able to reduce the crude oil import by 25,500 gallons. As the government is giving subsidies till the last 2020, they were able to replace the complete crude oil is 3,52,000 gallons per day they were able to replace. Imagine how much of a dent they have given to the crude oil suppliers. So they have drastically reduced now. If you look at the world electric vehicle program, China has the highest number of electric vehicles. More than 90% is, by that time 2019, 99% of the electric vehicles are in China only. But since other countries also slowly adopting, they are still above 95% of the electric vehicles. Still, 95% of the world electric vehicles are in China only even today. So this is at a glance given about its how do you compare the fuel cell energy? It's a hydrogen storage equivalent energy in comparison with the batteries. Typically, this is the battery specific energy. So the typically the watt hours per kg, the highest is NCA battery. NCA battery can have highest is 250 watt hours per kg. But whereas if you use hydrogen cylinder, the net power after fuel cell conversion, you will get 658 watt hours per kg, which is three times close to now the fuel cell's efficiency also improved like anything. It is giving almost three times of the battery specific energy density. So this is a kind of a, what to say, taking a decision kind of things. Some coincide points where if you keep on increasing the one on the x-axis is the battery energy. If you keep on increasing the onboard energy to obtain more mileage, then the weight of the total weight of the batteries will be keep on increasing linearly, because typically the battery weight is more than 8 kgs per kilowatt hour. So at some point of time, the fuel cell's weight will be, if you look at the whole picture, above 350 kilometers. This is based on our lab results. We have made this calculations, but in reality, the weight of the fuel cell system will be crossing or can overcome at an energy levels of 200 kilowatt hours. So at the time of 200 kilowatt hours, energy equivalent of battery weight is, it can overcome the fuel cell, which is of equivalent weight. You will get a 350 kilometers if you are working with the fuel cell. So that is the, if you look at the economics, once you cross the 400 kilometers, this is still we took at the higher side, but once you cross the 350 kilometers range, the economics will match. Okay. That is the cost of battery system and cost of the hybrid system. Cost of hybrid means here we are considered a fuel cell anyhow it is there, and a little amount of battery is there, some 50 kilowatt hours energy battery is there to function all the startup devices, any acceleration, deceleration time when there is a need of power, it can still serve. So this is one of the consultant, internationally renowned consultant has given, that is Deloitte, and the famous fuel cell manufacturer Ballard. They claim that by 2025, fuel cells will be cheaper in terms of total cost of ownership. Total cost of ownership means you have the cost of capital, one time purchase what you have given to the dealer, and the operating cost daily which you are doing. Over a span of some 10 years, 5 years, if you see, by 2025, the batteries will be more costlier than the fuel cell hybrid electric vehicles. By 2028, because of the stringent norms coming in the near future, like you see, suddenly we jumped from BS4 norm to BS6 norms. So because of that, the price of the vehicle has been increased by 50,000 rupees in cars, 50,000 to 70,000 rupees they have increased. Even in two-wheelers, they have increased by 7 to 10,000 rupees. So because it requires a different kind of mechanism, and the kind of catalytic converter you place at the exhaust should meet the norms of the BS6, because it should not, and the fuel cost also will increase, because the fuel should have a less sulfur in the BS6 fuel grade, whereas in the BS4 fuel grade you will have a 100 ppm of sulfur, whereas in BS6 grade fuel you will have a 10 ppm of sulfur on. So you see how much of reduction happened. Almost they have reduced by 90%. So you have to spend, that means when you are reducing the sulfur, you need a hydrogen to reduce the sulfur desulfurization. So the sulfur is converted through desulfurization units to further reduce the sulfur content in the fuel, final fuel to be given to the outlets. So that adds cost on the fuel, as well as to accommodate the further to regulate the meet the norms of the exhaust. These manufacturers will add an additional power catalytic converter where they use more amount of platinum and ruthenium to reduce the levels of the pollution. So that adds additional cost in the kind of a catalyst. So if you look at the replacement cost, again after 10 years or 7 years you have to change all this catalytic converter, all these things. So it adds additional maintenance cost. So all this together is a total cost of ownership. So if you look at that, by 30 at any cost, these fuel cells will dominate the IC engines also. This is the takeaway message from this slide. So typical, this is about the, all about the, why do we have to work in fuel cells? What is the need for fuel cells in future applications in transportation? This is about the hydrogen energy. So the fuel cell means, just like that fuel cell, it cannot work, give any power. You need a hydrogen. So like an engine requires a fuel cell requires a fuel, that is a hydrogen. So why hydrogen is required? Because of these following reasons. Because the fossil fuel is going to be depleted in future slowly by different surveys, claim by 2050 you may not find fossil fuels, and 2080 you will not find any amount. That's okay, these are all let it be there. But apart from that, you have a big problem of global warming. Already we have seen a fluctuation in the climates, the drastic change in the climate variations. To accommodate all these things, before industrialization, now the COP agreement has been signed to reduce the global temperature by 1.5 degrees centigrade by different means. Particularly, they are targeting most emission segments are power plants, automobile and cement industries and steel industry. These four are the major culprits for the global warming and releases more amount of pollutants that in turn results in a global warming. But currently, to combat the pollution, people are currently using lithium-ion batteries for transportable applications. And the advantage with the hydrogen is it can be produced from wide variety of feedstocks, like a biomass, and if you want, you can use a electrolysis of water and natural gas, and villages and all practicing this from cow dung they get a CNG and some CO also, that can also be converted to hydrogen through reformation process or gasification. And the other kind of a issue is, nowadays, if you see, many of the states are reaching surplus power. I hope Orissa also has reached surplus power. And AP, Chhattisgarh, like some 6-7 states already reached surplus power. So, and from the government point of view, to enhance the GDP and all, you have to keep driving the economy. So, now the government is pushing more on the renewable energy segment, because we have signed a COP agreement in Paris to reduce the pollution. So, because of that national solar mission of phase 1 is over, now phase 2, I think 185 gigawatts we have to achieve by 2025. Now the solar total renewable energy is somewhere around 80 gigawatts. So there is a long way. We have to double it. By 2025, we should be able to meet 185 gigawatts from the government point of view. And in that direction, things are going good only. Nowadays, if you see solar installations and wind installations are increasing like anything. Earlier, we used to see 50 megawatt of solar itself considered to be very big. Nowadays, it's nothing. People are talking about 1,000 megawatt solar, 4,000, 2,000, 500 megawatts. Such scale people are talking about. So that is the excess availability of solar energy is another big drawback to handle the grid issues. So majority of the disturbance powers adds to the grid, it creates the chaos for the grid. So you need another scheme. So you have to decentralize the energy supply chain. So for which you have to consume at local sites, or you convert them into any kind of energy storage form. Either you store it in battery, or you convert into through electrolysis to a hydrogen. But battery, how much you can store? Storing in battery 100 megawatt hours or 1000 megawatt hours requires a huge amount of cost. That is a horrible price. So because of all these reasons, people are trying to use that excess energy to convert to hydrogen, because that makes a valuable product to compete with the oil cost. So these are the different means of hydrogen production routes: electrolysis of water, which we have discussed initially, electrolysis of carbon dioxide to carbon monoxide, you can convert into any useful chemicals, and biomass gasification, chloralkali process, where hydrogen is a byproduct and sodium hydroxide is the main product there. The reformation of fossil fuels with CO2 sequestration, people are adopting in foreign states. And coal gasification, where China is taking the lead. They call it as a brown, blue and green. Brown means it gives every ton of hydrogen is being generated, 10 tons of CO2 will be generated in coal, or more than 10. In case of fossil fuels conversion, it generates every ton of hydrogen is being generated with CO2 sequestration, you will have still 8 tons of CO2. Whereas in green hydrogen, you have no CO2, because CO2 itself will not be released. So these are the energy contents of different fuels. If you look at the specific energy density, that is kilowatt hours per kg, hydrogen will have the highest energy density. That is in terms of a mass, but in terms of volume, hydrogen will have the lowest, because its molecular weight is only hydrogen H2 is only 2 grams per gram mole. And the next stance is highest is natural gas, because it has the highest hydrogen content, 1:4, as it is a CH4. So if you look at the efficiencies, so the methane reformation will have the highest conversion efficiency, and electrolysis also has reasonably good. But it requires 50 units of electricity to get the 1 kg of hydrogen. Okay, that is the drawback. But when you have so much of excess energy left with you, what to do with that, we don't know. Such cases, you can opt for it. and many foreign countries in Europe are trying for it because they have already reached surplus power and they are producing hydrogen and injecting into the CNG nearby grids. And coal gasification, this biomass gasification could be a better choice for India because with this program, government can do the rural empowerment. So where do you feel that some paddy cannot be grown, there they can grow the biomass through which you can generate hydrogen that can be used for multiple applications for industrial use so that the farmers will be empowered with this. So if you look at this is about the green hydrogen. If you look at the power demand for years from 70s onwards, if you see, the solar energy started just early of 2000, but the change of the acceleration, if you see, solar has the highest acceleration. It is increasing very steep. And nowadays it is going like mad. The thermal power stations are coming down and no new power stations are coming for the last, no new tenders have come for the last 1 year or 2 years. But solar tenders are coming like anything. Some gigawatt scales it is coming. So the similar way, the demand for in future, the solar will dominate. Currently, the 60% of our energy is given by the thermal power. Remaining 40 is coming from various means. It could be hydro, it could be wind, it could be gas turbine, it could be nuclear, it could be solar. So once the excess power comes, what to do? We have to convert it to electrolysis. Once you convert using electrolysis, you can convert it to different kind of electrolyzers to convert that water to hydrogen, useful gas. So that is the advantage. So within that, you have multiple types of electrolyzers. And in that, the most commercially proven is alkaline electrolyzer. And that is alkaline electrolyzer is being commercially successful now. But recent technologies in the recent trends, the PEM based fuel technology, also electrolysis technologies, is giving tough competition for the alkaline because of its, though it is 30% is costlier than the alkaline, but the life and maintenance is easy in PEM based electrolyzers. Solid oxide electrolyzers are still at premature stage, very small scale demonstrations are going on, but not they are being offered in commercial scales. But once it is successful, this will definitely overcome the all these things because the efficiency, if you look at solid oxide, is the highest. So the cost of hydrogen will come down drastically. So this is the capital cost of the electrolyzers that is at different time scales and how the PEM and alkaline. So PEM stands at the lowest in terms of cost. PEM will be a little higher. Solid oxide is also more or less same with the alkaline. These are all the projections given by the different consulting agencies. So altogether, I have consolidated. So this time presenting the slide taken from them. So capital investment in case of a blue hydrogen, in case of a reformation process. So the capital investment required is only few millions, whereas in case of if you look at the typically the cost, capital cost in case of blue hydrogen is typically 50% of that. That is the advantage in case of it's all reformation routes. So this is one of the, we have an electrolyzer within our office. We worked based on our data what we had on different schemes. So if you run the electrolyzer purely with the solar, the cost of hydrogen is arriving at 900 rupees. But if you run it with energy storage, then it is coming around 400 rupees. If you run with the grid connected electricity, it is coming around 500 plus. So the advantage, you have to trade off according to your availability, wherever the cost of the unit is cheaper. If it costs below 3 rupees, continuously, then the price of the hydrogen will go down below 350 also. So this is the national status recently. Multiple tenders are coming and expression of interest are coming by Ministry of Renewable Energy is issuing multiple projects for railway applications, bus applications. And recently Reliance is also venturing in a huge manner like Jio. They are also planning to venture into hydrogen and fuel cells. Maybe in a couple of months, they may set up a huge plant also. So that is the government is taking very serious now in this regard to promote the renewable programs. Even already government started demonstrating HCNG vehicles in NCR Delhi region. About some 50 vehicles are being under demonstration, where the 20% of the hydrogen is mixed in the CNG. So that is being demonstrated at this is program is taken over by the IOCL from the government of India. They are the in charge for that. They are dealing, and NTPC also planning to demonstrate few buses, cars in the Leh Ladakh. Recently, we have they got a separate state in Leh Ladakh. So they would like to make the complete Leh Ladakh as a renewable kind of energy systems. So government is thinking like that. And Indian Railway also planning to run few trains with the fuel cell based power systems. Recently, IOCL has floated a tender for demonstration of 15 fuel cell buses in Delhi. So it has been awarded to Tata Motors. Recently, Tata Motors won the tender. So probably the program will start maybe sometime in the October or November, I guess. So this is the current status. And I think DST has given an announcement also. That is there up to 30th of this month, till the end of this month. They are inviting huge programs, up to 10 crores their funding per program. So if you have any of one interested, but they are all kind of a deliverable oriented, not pure science. They have to deliver and demonstrate certain things, not for the pure development program. They are all kind of a techno-commercial type of things. So this is the cost given by the MNRE recently from different sources of raw material and process you choose. So steam methane reformation, from the steam methane reformation, the government has priced at 180 rupees, that is the production cost. Biomass gasification, currently it is little cost, but it is expected to come down or match with the SMR process. So electrolyzer is 440 rupees, but it is currently it is already close to 400. So this data is around 2020 Feb data, but things are changing now. So coal gasification is coming around 170 rupees. It is close to steam methane values only. So these are the hydrogen cost in different countries. If you see, China is having the lowest price of hydrogen because they get from the coal gasification. So, and Paris, that is the French government, is subsidizing about some €3 for the customer to promote the use of hydrogen. South Korea also similar, $7.5, where the government is giving $1, I think, subsidy. And Japan is the actual price is $9.85. And cost of hydrogen recently in US, one of the NEL hydrogen, that is a big player in the hydrogen systems and complete filling stations, they are offering at $5 per kg at power cost of, you should assure that the power cost of $60 megawatt hour power cost. So Germany, I have seen this price has declined recently. Currently, in around 2018, it was €9.7, but now it has reduced to €9. The hydrogen in California, it is 13.5. It is 1 year old back price, but now it is close to $12.5. So the price of hydrogen is coming down year and year because of advancements happening across the globe in the area of hydrogen technologies. So business applications, typically the hydrogen is refineries, they use large amount of, highest amount of currently used hydrogen is in refinery for desulfurization of fuels, which we use as a low sulfur content fuel. And the steel industries, instead of using the carbon coke is being used currently as a reducing agent from the iron oxide to from ore to extract the iron. But green hydrogen is being promoted. In this concern, one plant in Sweden is completely running with hydrogen, steel plant. So transportation, as you all know, fuel cells will be used. So through which the green hydrogen promotion will be carried. Fertilizer industry, you know, ammonia is required for all the raw material to make any fertilizer products. So to make ammonia, you need a hydrogen. So semiconductor industries requires high pure hydrogen. So for manufacturing of semiconductor, for reduction process they use it. So other than that, they use in making vanaspati oil from the conventional oils. So they call it as a hydrogenation of oils. Of course, in power plants, we do use in DC cooling. So because the hydrogen has the CP value of hydrogen is much more than the other gases, and hydrogen is being used there. Though it is not safe, but because of the technical requirements, we have to use in case of a big power plant. So above 400 megawatt scale, people use hydrogen cooling. So weather stations, you all know, it is used in balloons. So pharma industries, they use for the chromatograph applications. Instead of helium gas, they use for the chromatograph application because it is cheaper than the helium gas. These are the different class of fuel cells which you have been maybe taught for the last 2 days from different participants already. So probably I need not to cover much, but out of which the most commercially successful fuel cells are now PEM fuel cells and solid oxide fuel cells. So within these two, PEM is standing at high. 80% of the market share is still occupied by PEM fuel cells only. So this is kind of a basics, how the, just this is before going to the systems level, I'm just touching upon. So any fuel cell consists of a typical three parts, two electrodes, one electrolyte. So that sandwich together to form like a membrane electrode assemblies, that is the key component. On top of that, you will have a graphite plate. And finally, that is interfaced with a current collector plate. These are symmetric on either side. And if at all you want higher voltage applications or higher power applications, such cells will be connected electrically in series, mechanically they look to be parallel. So we develop all the components, majority of the components we develop, but only that electrode raw materials and membranes we typically buy. And catalyst powder is a material given by the different players, even in India you can get it. So this is the system. Fuel cell stack alone cannot work. It requires a different kind of other supporting systems. So to perform better, the fuel cell stack has to be humidified continuously. So to have to maintain the wet conditions. This is complete picture I have given, probably you could see individual requirement in the later slides. So such systems will be placed either in bus or truck, wherever it is, in combination with the batteries. So you have a fuel cell system, it's a 12 meter bus. And of course you have a battery and you have a hydrogen storage. Typically hydrogen cylinders will be placed at the top of the bus because of safety reasons. and batteries. Of course, fuel cells will be typically placed at the under the passenger's place at the back side, so that that place is good enough and which will not disturb the people's occupation also. So this is about the function of each. I'm just giving a brief. So fuels, out of fuel cells, to make such systems, so fuel cell stack is the main heart of the system. So it uses, it gives the DC power. So as long as you supply the hydrogen and air, so there will not be any issue of the supply for the hydrogen and air. As long as you supply, you get the power. So reactor supply, there is separate subsystems for that. For supplying the oxygen, it is being supplied in the form of air. And hydrogen is supplied through cylinders by different reduction processes of pressure and flow rate. So humidification is the one which requires to maintain the your cell under hydrated conditions. You have to pre-humidify, or you have to inject the water vapor or water in atomized form in before the gases are entering into the fuel cell stack. So as you all know, it is an exothermic reaction. So you have a some heat generated. If you keep on leaving it, it will blast. So you have to control the temperature. To control the temperature at desired value, you have to circulate the coolant. You may have liquid coolant as a primary loop, again you will have a secondary loop as a air cooling, like a, what you have a radiators in autos, in automobiles. And fuel cells does not give a constant voltage because of its nature, and it has different losses. As you draw more and more current, you will have more losses you undergo. The cell will undergo more amount of losses, by which the voltage of the cell will keep on dropping as you increase the power, or the as you increase the amount of current which you draw from the cell. So for which you need a power converter, which takes the wide variation in the input side and gives you the output power as a constant voltage. Like you see in your two-wheeler electric handle, you will have a 48 volts DC motor. In car, you may have 96 voltage DC or 210 DC, such kind of constant voltage to be fed to the motor applications or any user applications. So battery management, without battery or nowadays you cannot start anything. So the battery, even in conventional vehicles also, you need a battery. So for such reasons, the battery also is required here, not only to start the fuel cells system, also to manage the, in case of any accelerations or deceleration, sudden power, if there is a demand, it takes a for short time, 3 seconds or 4 seconds, it may take it from the battery also. So lot of instrumentation, control subsystems, these are all required to ensure the safety, and different warning calls, and these all things will be finally integrated with the vehicle control unit of the where it is placed, and it gives all the indicative measures to the driver. So main importance is why the fuel cell is more important transport is quick refueling, and onboard hydrogen provides fuel to hybrid e-bus with very less weight typically, and the emissions are nil as long as you use a hydrogen as the product, as a feed. And the main advantage is it's an fuel independence you will get it. That is the major advantage here. So we need not to depend on the foreign crude oil, so that our currency can be protected to certain level, because majority of the foreign exchange is given for the 30% of the foreign exchange is paid for the crude oil. So you imagine how much we can save our currency value. We can retain our currency value to avoid the fluctuations. And the cost of the fuel cell system when compared with the battery vehicles is only 30% of the fuel cell system cost when you go for a replacement after warranty. But whereas in batteries, you have to pay 70% of the battery cost when you go for replacement after warranty, which could be 5 years or it could be 7 years. So fuel cell is not limited to anyone's domain. It is a multidisciplinary domain where you need a mechanical engineers, metallurgy engineers, chemical engineers, physics, chemistry, electronics, instrumentation people. And yeah, it's a kind of a composite kind of things. It's not limited to any one subject. It is a mix of many. So these are all the different products we have developed in the journey of last 20 years in the lab. But I started working in DHL for the last 11 years. From here, I started working. So this was my first project. So my previous colleagues have developed all this base technology. One of that project is MNRE funded only. And one was demonstrated initially at a BPCL oil bunk. So this is like a diesel generator. So it's just there are only two buttons, red and green. To start, you just press the green button. To stop or in case of any emergency, you just press the red button. So to such an extent, we have simplified the system. So this is one of the system further we have enhanced for the automobile applications. So where we have tested the system keeping running a golf cart vehicle with the fuel cell system. So probably you could see that village. And recently we have developed a 5 kilowatt liquid cooled system also. This is one of that stack of the system. So you could see probably that these are all the product specifications we have developed. So this is the how the fuel cell, battery and motor, how it behaves in case of real time, the dynamic behavior. So suddenly when the motor demands more current, the red is a motor current, that is the load demanded by the motor. So that time if the fuel cell cannot be able to give for short transients, then it will take some help from the battery also. So it takes initially from the battery, then slowly it will supplement. Sometimes it will charge the battery also. If you see certain cases, you will have when the motor current is very low. So such cases, the fuel cell will have the higher current. In that case, it is charging the battery. That means the power is going in the other direction. That's why it is showing here as a negative. So in such cases, the battery is getting charged. So this is one of the recent concepts we have worked on. So from solar, we are powering the electrolyzer. We are generating the hydrogen, which is stored in the hydrogen bank. And it is used that from hydrogen bank, we are fueling the golf cart. This is well-to-wheel full system we have developed in our campus. So these are all the assembling systems within the vehicle. So hydrogen cylinders were placed at the backside, small like a oxygen cylinders, which use medical grade oxygen cylinders. Such size only we have used for demonstration purpose. Four cylinders were used, and under this passenger's seating place, this is the one we have placed the complete fuel cell system. Here there are some controls, battery, all the other systems were placed under the driver's seat. So these are all the different subsystems being developed at BHL. So we ultimately aim for offering the complete product for commercial need applications. So this is one of the live vehicle testing performance. So probably you have a feel how the fuel cell works. It was developed in the year 2018 October. So we have tested this vehicle for more than 2 years. Still, even now also is running well. This is our campus within the BHL R&D Hyderabad. We have about some 150 acres campus. It's very green. We enjoy the campus. Of course, it is spanned with 22 labs across the campus at different places. So out of these 9, we have a center of excellences within the campus. So it is an effort of not me, it is an effort of some 4 or 5 departments. This is. Yeah, thank you for all your patience listening through whole session. It is, I think, more than hour. I guess you people must have got bored or not. If you have any questions, please let me know. Hello?
Dear participants, if you have any queries, you can raise.
Good evening, sir. Hello, sir. I am Dr. P. Pirisamy, Associate Professor in Chemistry, Dr. Mahalingam Engineering College, Pollachi, Tamil Nadu.
Mm-hmm.
Sir, for the past 1 hour, we were excited on your lecture. And one doubt, sir, suppose if there is a leakage in the cylinder, okay, what will happen to the safety measures?
No, we have a, because that I have not shown you clearly, there is at the cylinder bank, there is a hydrogen leak detector, and within the, under the seat also, there is a hydrogen leak detector. So if there is any leakage, it can capture the alarms. The driver will get a red light and alarm also.
Okay, okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah.
Hello, sir. Hello. Hello.
Yes, please.
Yeah, sir. Thank you, sir. Thanks for your insightful presentation. Actually, I want to ask, you are talking about lithium cost and lithium reservoirs, okay? But what about platinum cost and what about platinum reserves? Is there any effect on our fuel cell program?
Yeah, but platinum is not the only metal. Platinum, people are replacing platinum also slowly. Currently, the FC, when I started working in fuel cells, the platinum loading was 1 milligram per square centimeter. Now it has come down to 0.2 milligrams per square centimeter. See what is the reduction happened. But the recycling is easy here. The catalyst can be recycled here. You need not to waste.
Okay.
So that is the advantage.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you. And also we know that BHL is the one of the pioneer in India making fuel cells.
Yeah. Thank you.
I'll contact you later, sir. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Hello. 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 Hello.
Hello, sir. Are you there? Hello.
Hello, any query from audience?
Hello sir, I'm audible.
Introduce yourself.
I am Manikanda Magaraj, Department of Green Energy Technology from Pondicherry University.
Yeah, you can ask a question to Dr. Vasu.
Yes sir. Sir, Professor. You showed in that gold card vehicle, that cylinder capacity, weight, how much, sir? Base weight of that cylinder.
Hello, sir. I think, unfortunately, that Vasu Garling, sir, is left on meeting. I think there is an internet problem.
Is it?
Yes, sir. I am unable to see him. Yes, sir.
You call him. Otherwise, should you wait or because of internet? You ask him. Hello?
Yes, sir.
We called you, huh? No, you call him, man. Some participants, should we wait? Ask him, otherwise we'll close.
Sir, I have tried to calling you, but he is on another call.
Okay. Yes, sir. Probably because of another call he is disconnected.
I think so, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We have taken attendance. Otherwise, we will wait for one more minute. Sir, I have tried to calling again also. Again, he is in call only, another call.
Okay, then I thank Dr. Vasu Golangi, General Manager, the Fuel Cell Research Center, BHL Hyderabad, for giving very much informative and wonderful lecture. So today's session is over because of some network issues. We are unable to continue. So I thank Dr. Vasu Golangi for his wonderful lecture, which is very much informative. Tomorrow we will start with one industry lecture that will be given by Dr. Velayudham, Sai Energy, Chennai. He will talk about the fuel cell components. So I request all the participants to assemble at 8:20. Join at 8:20 so that you will learn something about the fuel cell components. So today I thank everyone to attend this program with enthusiasm. So we'll join tomorrow. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.